Welcome to Drinking Made Easy. This week, we're in Washington, D.C.
District of Cocktails.
Yeah.
Look at my thing.
It's actually pretty impressive. In this episode of Drinking Made Easy, we visit our nation's capital. We play with a chainsaw. We have a snowball fight. And Steve shows how to properly handle a 44 Magnum. It's Drinking Made Easy, Washington, D.C. I'm Zane Lamprey, and my job is to drink. I'm traveling around with my mascot, Steve McKenna, and my buddy Pleplius as we explore local drinking cultures, customs, and cocktails. Along the way, we'll soak in the local flavor in an effort to make drinking easy. Before we start drinking, we head out to the Maryland Small Arms Range, where Steve and I take aim on this week's six-pack challenge.
Today's six-pack challenge, before we've had anything to drink, this is the morning right now. Have you ever fired a gun before?
Never.
Okay.
You?
No.
It's time for the six-pack challenge.
Now, any dummy knows that drinking and guns don't go together. So I want to point out that Lamprey and McKenna are completely sober. They got proper training from an instructor, and Washington, D.C. detective Tom Webb is here to make sure that everything is safe. Here's how the scoring works. You get 10 points for shooting inside the red, 9 points for the next ring, 8 points for that one, 7 points for the fringe, and nothing outside of that.
We will say that you did grow up in the mountains. Like, people around you hunted, right?
Not with handguns.
Oh, and I grew up in Syracuse, and so no, same thing. So neither one of us has any handgun experience whatsoever.
None. Good luck.
Yeah, good luck.
Good luck to both of you.
Pea shooter McKenna is up first, and he looks uncomfortable.
There you go. Closer. Relax. Get a good sight picture. And squeeze.
Jesus.
That's right. The 44 really packs a wallop. He's in the red, and that's 10 points.
Nice.
Beneath the red, right on the number 9. That gives him 19 out of a possible 20.
Nice.
That's 9 more points, giving him a total of 28.
Mountain man, girl.
That's below the 9, only 8 points. Oh, that was low. Right in the bad guy's crotch. No points. Last round in the chamber.
Let's last in the red. Let's go.
And he gets it in the red. Total of 46 points out of a possible 60.
Good job.
Woo! That was rowdy.
Man.
Now it's Dirty Lamprey's turn. He appears cool, but looks can be deceiving. Here's his first shot.
Slowly squeeze the trigger.
He's in the red. That is 10 points.
I'll crack it again.
Shot number 2. Even more accurate. Wow, 20 out of a possible 20. Round number 3. Right on target. That's 40 out of a possible 40. If Lamprey even gets a 7 here, he will beat Steady Hands McKenna. And it's another 10-point shot. Lamprey has won, but he's looking for the perfect score. Lamprey gets a perfect score, 60 out of 60, and is the winner of this week's six-pack challenge.
Pretty cool. You've really never fired a gun before?
Now I have. You better watch out.
Now, onto the drinking. Our first watering hole is one of the city's oldest bars. Tune In is the hangout for local fire and law enforcement, but we're here for their satirical cocktails.
You guys opened in what year?
1947. We're the second oldest liquor license in the city. We're family owned. We haven't changed locations. If you walked in here 50 years ago and then came in today, you'd walk in and say, man, this place hasn't changed a bit.
And there's a photo of, is it your grandfather?
My grandfather's right here.
This guy.
And he opened up the bar.
Why Toon? Was
that was the brothers, the Toon brothers.
Oh, okay. These are ironic cocktails.
Absolutely.
So we'll start with the Bill Clinton.
Our first drink is the Bill Clinton. The Bill Clinton is made with vodka, coffee liqueur, cream, and blue curacao. In a shaker of ice, pour vodka, coffee liqueur,
Okay, are you looking at all the ingredients?
Yes.
There's a test afterwards.
And then we've got the cream, the key ingredient.
And cream. Shake and pour into a shot glass. Then top with blue curacao. Now it's appropriate that this is a little messy.
And we've had spillage.
We've had spillage.
Yeah.
Now, Steve, do you understand the significance of why this is called Bill Clinton?
I don't really know.
What do you know about Bill Clinton?
Well, he got a blowjob from Monica Lewinsky.
Right, exactly.
So is that like a blowjob drink?
Well, yeah, you see, it has cream in it. The blue is the blue dress. And so this is a shot representing that. Thanks.
Exactly.
Thanks.
To a T.
I mean, that is...
Well done.
You get it. You're about to. So this is a big load for one person to take. Not bad.
Not bad.
That's what he said.
It's tasty. And that's what she said.
I did not have relations with that cup. Hey, where's my new bar towels?
Clean bar, happy bar?
Let me wipe this bar down with a clean place towel.
Our next drink is named after D.C.'s most notorious mayor. Marion Barry was?
Mayor of Washington.
Right. Wow, that's impressive.
Mayor Washington, D.C.
Impressive. The Marion Barry is made with ice, blueberry vodka, and Coke. Do you understand the significance of this yet? The first satirical ingredient is ice. The ice represents something. We'll get to that in a second. Then blueberry vodka.
We're heavy-handed. We're known for that.
And cola.
Wait a minute. I think I get
it
now.
Wait a minute.
This is the Marion Barry. Okay, Steve, why?
The blueberry vodka represents Mayor Barry, Marion Barry, because
blue is a berry.
It's a berry.
Yeah. And what's the ice represent?
The ice is crack cocaine.
Yeah.
And the Coke is, well, it's probably he was doing Coke too.
Yeah.
He was our mayor, standing mayor at the time, and he was busted for.
For doing Coke.
With the hooker.
With the hooker.
On camera. Now he's standing on the city council.
Sweet.
Currently standing on the city council.
Oh, that makes a lot of sense. Where we see straws, Lamprey sees a race.
What are we doing with this? Racing?
I think we're racing.
Entirely appropriate.
Toast?
To city councilman Marion Barry.
Oh, absolutely.
And they're off. Steve and Lisa quickly jump into the lead, leaving Lamprey behind. Wow, that was a close one.
Was that a tie?
I think you and I tied.
Did you guys tie?
I think
we tied.
Let's go to the replay. On closer inspection, it's clear that Lisa takes it by a sip. Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, the tool every bar should have, a chainsaw. Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy. You know, this is a drinking show, but it's also a drinking game. So with any game, there are rules involved. For example, here's one rule. Whenever you see the White House in this episode, you have to drink.
Drink.
Whenever I drink, you have to take a drink. When you see Pleiplius, the monkey, you get to make someone else drink. And then, yeah, that's a rule. For all the rules, go to drinkingmadeeasy.com. We are drinking our way through the nation's capital, and our next stop has been a haunt for dozens of American presidents. The Round Robin Bar inside the Willard Hotel has been so heavily associated with politicians in history that it's reputed to be the actual political center of D.C., more so than the Capitol building. And we're here to try a Capitol cocktail, the Mint Julep. You're known as the Residence of Presidents, the Willard.
This is the Residence of Presidents in beautiful downtown Washington, D.C., a block from the White House.
Right.
And at one time, everything in Washington took place within 10 blocks of the White House. So the Willard Hotel, being so close to the White House, being a place where senators, congressmen, business people would stay here and intermingle, Henry Willard was very, very astute in realizing that, well, if I can get the president to stay here and his people, I can attract everybody else.
If I can say that the president stays here, he can stay for free and...
Exactly, and it's gonna rain, and that's what happened. He put the Willard on the map. Within 20 years, the Willard Hotel, it was world famous. We are historic. You know, there's been a hotel in this site going back to about 1808. And that legacy continues. There's this historic context here.
The Round Robin also has a rich drinking history.
Henry Clay was a senator and statesman from Kentucky. So he comes to Washington, and for the next 50 years dominated American politics. Clay was known as a great compromiser, perhaps over a couple of tumblers of mint juleps. There was a gentleman, and he wrote under his surname Captain Marriott. He wrote about this mint julep being made with brandy or rum. And Henry Clay made a point of meeting him at the Old City Hotel on this site and instructing him in the proper manner to make a Southern-style mint julep.
Got it.
Made with Kentucky Sour Mash whiskey.
We're gonna make that happen right now.
As Henry Clay would have. A cocktail that evokes an era of hospitality and congeniality.
The mint julep is made with sugar, whiskey, mint, and sparkling water. First, add a tablespoon of sugar to some chilled glasses. Then add sour mash whiskey.
Is that too much?
Yeah, way too much. But anyway, we're on our way. We're making what is known as a tea. This is the base. This is the heart and soul of the drink.
Muddle with mint with a knife.
Get a little wrist action in there.
Then add a scoop of ice.
Maybe a little more.
And stir.
You're sweetening the ice.
Add some more ice.
There you go.
And top off each glass with equal parts whiskey and sparkling water.
There you go.
Garnish with a sprig of mint and a twist of lemon.
Oh, yeah.
And finish by topping it off with some sugar.
It's one of the most social and elegant of cocktails, and a fitting showcase for a truly American invention, which is bourbon.
Cheers.
Wow. Here's to Senator Henry Clay and,
Henry Clay, and
the lightest of libations.
Mm-hmm. Yummy.
That is how Henry Clay would have made a mint julep. As they say, one's not enough, three's too many, two's just right.
Our next stop is across town at the Beer Baron, where they have the largest beer selection in D.C. With over 600 beers in cans, bottles, and on tap, Beer Baron is a veritable beer mecca.
You guys have about 600 beers.
Correct.
As I understand it, around 552 in bottles and around 50 on the taps.
We have rotating seasonals. We try and keep a lot of the beers consistent. The taps are always rotating, though.
Okay. But you also make
beer tails.
A beer tail. Yeah. And this beer tail is called the Neapolitan.
So we could taste three beers at once. We're combining them to make one of Beer Baron's famous beer tails, the Neapolitan. The Neapolitan beer tail is made with Frambois Lambic, Belgian White, and a float of chocolate stout.
There you go, that's a champ right there.
So it really is close to an actual Neapolitan. It's like a berry,
yeah.
A vanilla, which is the white, and then the chocolate.
Yeah.
I'm very excited.
All the best.
Wow, delicious.
We met up with Brandon Skull to ask him about his unique DC brewery.
Of all the beers here that I could try, I would like to try a DC Brow, which is a new beer town.
That's right.
Which is DC's only brewery.
Well, we are the first production and package facility in DC in about 50 years.
Okay.
There are a few brew pubs in town, but we're the first brewery that's only concerned with distribution off-premise.
We then tried one of DC Brow's beers called The Corruption.
All right. This beer is called The Corruption.
Wait, why Corruption DC? That makes no sense.
Makes
There's
no sense
no
at all, right?
Analogy to DC.
We thought that was kind of a fun play with the words there, because one of the things people say about IPAs is that they're often so hoppy, you'll find that they corrupt the palate.
You're all corruption all right, right there,
yeah,
my friend.
I can see.
Yeah, see the cloudiness there?
Yeah, for
yep.
sure.
Yep.
Wow. So is the style almost similar to a West Coast IPA?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Yep.
Steve, you want to try it?
Yeah.
Steve loves hoppy beers. Good job, buddy.
Woo.
Did you enjoy it?
Yes, I still am.
So how many beers do you guys make?
We just released a porter about 2 weeks ago.
You just released a porter? You just opened. I mean, everything kind of...
Well, we're doing it all at once, man.
Let me guess, the business plan was like this. Make beer, sell beer.
Yeah. Make beer, sell beer, drink beer.
Done. Here, Steve, you know what? You finish these.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Got some work to do.
So if you wouldn't mind sort of just getting to those.
Thanks.
You might want to save this one for last.
I'm going to save them all for last.
Our next stop is a speakeasy inside a bar called The Passenger. The Columbia Room is a Prohibition-style cocktail lounge that focuses on mixology. We meet up with Derek Brown to learn how to make an original DC libation.
You guys make a staple cocktail, DC's native cocktail,
invented in the 1880s here in Washington, D.C.
And this is the Ricky.
The gin.
However, caveat, this is a gin Ricky.
Right.
And the original Ricky was a bourbon, rye, Ricky?
Somewhere between 1881 and 1883 is when it was invented. Colonel Joe Ricky was the one who ordered it. People came in and started asking for that Joe Ricky drink or a Ricky drink.
Okay.
And the result was people started asking for a Ricky.
Okay.
In the 1890s, it started being mixed with gin, and that became the most popular incarnation of it.
The Gin Ricky is made with lime juice, gin, and sparkling mineral water.
So we start off with a lime, right?
Right.
First, squeeze a half lime into a glass, then we have to make ice cubes. Using larger ice cubes helps control the amount of dilution and doesn't water down your cocktail as much.
You think you can karate chop it?
For sure.
Whoa! I add one of my fresh cut ice cubes, then pour in a generous helping of gin.
It's like the American cousin of the gin and tonic, just a little livelier.
And top with mineral water.
It's a remarkably easy drink to make.
It's
especially
quick.
In the summertime, you don't want to spend too much effort. If you had both of them side by side, the bourbon one is delicious, but it is the gin one that is just absolutely refreshing.
I would like to take the Ricky test.
I compare the Gin Ricky to the original Bourbon Ricky, also called the Joe Ricky.
Experience aquavit, slow gin, gin. Bourbon, rye, whatever you want, you can add to it.
It's something that's very big in D.C.
Absolutely. I mean, and for obvious reasons. One, it was created by a lobbyist, so it has connects to our history. What do you think?
I think this is a little more fresh.
It's refreshing. And that's the thing, is in D.C., during the summer, it gets extremely hot here. Having something like this is essential to keep it cool. I would describe it as air conditioning in a glass.
All right. You want to try this?
Oh, yeah. Some people call this the Joe Ricky.
The Joe Ricky.
To distinguish it from whatever Ricky came after, because this is at least the one that Joe Ricky drank.
Oh, it's the it's the stuff where we.
Yeah, you understand that's his job.
Yes, of course.
I equally like them both.
People are calling this whole cocktail movement prohibition style, pre-prohibition style. What does that mean?
You have to understand that everybody during Prohibition thought, look, I know it's illegal, it's probably good that you don't drink, but I can drink because I can handle it. And that was sort of the attitude, and that's how Prohibition got passed in the first place.
It's sort of like, I can handle my booze, but most people can, the common man cannot, so I will continue to drink and then judge you for drinking.
Exactly.
Like I do with you.
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, a snowball fight.
Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy. If you want the locations that we went to today and recipes that you learned in today's show.
And for recipes that we forgot to mention.
Yeah. Well, you forgot to. I mentioned them all.
I didn't even know you wanted me to say that or not.
Okay. Go to drinkingmadeeasy.com.
We're lobbying our way through Washington, D.C., and our next stop is the Old Ebbitt Grill. Frequented by almost every president since Lincoln, the Old Ebbitt Grill is just steps away from the White House and a common meeting place for political players, journalists, and everyone else. It's also known for having some of the most experienced bartenders in town. We drop in to see how much Steve and I have learned.
This is one of the most well-known restaurants in D.C. and one of the busiest restaurants in the country. The bartending position here is a very coveted position. It's not like a schlep like Steve can just come here and then say, oh, you know, fill out an application, answer two questions, and then
jump behind the bar.
You continually test your bartenders, correct?
Yep.
So you have sort of an abridged version of a test that you can give me to see if I...
I think we've come up with something to see if you have what it takes to bartend the Old Ebbitt Grill.
Yeah, dude, bring it. Let's do it. Steve, we're going to have a bartending test.
The first step is the standard pour. Zane and Steve need to pour 1.5 ounces into a highball glass, 1.5 ounces into a rocks glass, and 2 ounces into a snifter. Lamprey's a little light on the pour.
Well, you're ripping off our guests by just a bit.
Warming up, stretching?
Yeah.
Now it's McKenna's turn. Even before the measure, you can tell that Steve's pours are light.
Looks a little light. Whoa.
Not even close. No points for either of them in round one. Round two, Lamprey and McKenna will be tested on the perfect Guinness pour.
I believe the proper cooking time is 99.6 seconds. All right, so that's it.
Nice.
The only thing I would say is...
Just tell me it's a pass or a fail.
It's a fail.
You're kidding me!
When you finish the pour at the end, so you don't get the big bubbles in there,
yeah,
you go back, because it's slower.
That's 0 points for Lamprey.
Give me a perfect Guinness pour.
What are you doing?
That's the first stage. You gotta wait for it.
How long do you wait?
90 seconds.
How do you know this?
Just from years of sitting where you're sitting.
Oh.
McKenna makes the same mistake and also gets a goose egg. In round three, they need to execute a proper wine pour.
And then the trick,
see if the proper pour is...
Oh, man.
Perfect.
Lamprey nails it.
Yes!
Now it's McKenna's turn. Somehow, he does it.
Is that a full point?
Yeah, that's a full point.
That's 1 point for each of them out of a possible three. Round number four is oral. Questions, that is.
Hendrick's gin has two unique ingredients. What are they?
Juniper berries and oranges.
That is wrong.
Limes.
Nope.
Mint. Rosemary.
No dice.
What?
It is rose petals and cucumber.
Really?
Yes, in Hendrick's gin.
No wonder it tastes like that.
Let's just call it 0.5. Hendrick's gin has two unique ingredients. What are they?
Cucumber and some flour.
He is correct.
Rose petal.
That's actually the right answer.
Is this a joke?
Is that right?
Come on.
Get out of here.
There's no way.
And Steve wins the Old Ebbitt Grill Bartending Challenge. Our next stop is the Gibson, where they're known for mixing up some artistic cocktails. We sit down with mixologist Jonathan Harris and discuss his original cocktail, the Bonfire Shelter.
I think the trend of cocktails right now will enable people to be more artistic. And that's something that we came here for, because you do something that's sort of...
It's different. It's not standard bar.
Jonathan was the winner of a cocktail competition called the Artini Contest, where he made a cocktail inspired by Albert Bierstadt's painting, The Last of the Buffalo. First, rub a small lemon peel inside a rocks glass. Add a dash of celery bitters. Next, John uses a French orange liqueur. Then a 1/2 ounce of bison grass infused with whiskey.
It's like almond, vanilla, cherry pit. And it goes pretty well with the spiciness.
An ounce of scotch, chartreuse.
Do you want to see what you can do with chartreuse?
Kind of like a Blood Brothers thing. Right?
Nice.
All right.
You dip your finger in that one, your middle finger.
Right now?
Yeah.
You probably shouldn't try this part at home.
Wow.
There. Word up.
Now that Steve and Jonathan have bonded, let's finish a drink.
Just doing a layer over the top.
Add the 6-year-old scotch.
Pricey scotch.
It's very pricey, which is why it's in this fancy bottle. Most everything you taste is actually a funky smell, so this is an exercise in taste and smell.
And the last step is applying a perfume that Jonathan developed specifically for this drink.
Perfume's called Bonfire Shelter. Same as the drink.
Same as the drink, okay.
You can think of it as smellable bitters. It'll change and modulate, and then the drink will change. What you're smelling will affect what you're tasting, what you're tasting will affect what you're smelling, and so on. It's like, and then, you know, you put it all together with the painting. You know.
I have a painting.
You have a painting?
Mm-hmm. Well, you gotta see it big, like this kid.
That changed everything.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Now, you said something about fire.
We finish off the evening with one of Jonathan's favorite drinks, the Merry Traveler. Their Merry Traveler is made with Averna Amaro, Saint Germain, Peychaud's Bitters, Angostura Bitters, a grapefruit twist, and a smoldering cinnamon stick.
It's a really fun drink.
We start with a rocks glass of crushed ice.
Here. Do you have a liquid?
Let's try that again. Start with a rocks glass of crushed ice, then add scotch. Next, add the Sicilian bitter liqueur, Averna Amaro, Saint Germain, 2 dashes of Peychaud's Bitters, Angostura Bitters, stir.
Keep the spoon along the edges. And suck at this, okay, clearly.
You gonna taste it?
So
this is how we've seen people taste it in the last year.
It's very pretentious.
Roll up. That was not.
And pour into the chilled rocks glass. Garnish with a twist of grapefruit peel.
Cinnamon sticks.
Yeah. And finish with a smoldering cinnamon stick.
Nestle it in there.
Ooh, that smells amazing.
It's like a cigar. I need a drink.
This is the same thing about mixing the aroma with the beverage, with the taste. We're just smoking cinnamon, don't worry about it.
Check us out on Facebook and at drinkingmadeeasy.com.